If, like me, you got the Moderna vaccine, you have our next guest to thank. Dr. Kizzmekia Corbett and her team at the National Institutes of Health spent years working on a vaccine for coronaviruses before COVID-19 hit. So Kizzy Corbett was ready when the sequencing of COVID-19 was revealed on a Friday in January of last year.
When we got those sequences, because we knew how to make that protein as a very good vaccine, we did that really quickly over the weekend. And by the 13th,
over the weekend.
Over the weekend. You know something about working on weekends, right?
Not like that.
And joining us now is Dr. Kizzy Corbett. She is the scientific lead for the coronavirus vaccine team at the National Institutes of Health. We want to let our audience know that as we approach the 11 o'clock hour, that the 11th hour with Brian Williams will be coming up shortly. We're just going to trespass on his time a bit to hear from Dr. Kizzy Corbett. And Dr. Corbett, the very strangest thing in what I heard you just say was over the weekend. Over the weekend. I can't think of a single important thing I did over a weekend except maybe study for exams in high school and college. The sequencing of the vaccine gets determined in January. You go to work, a sequence of the virus gets determined in January on a Friday afternoon, I think. And you just start working through the weekend. By the end of the weekend, you have your idea for what's gonna work as a vaccine?
Absolutely. You know why that is?
No, I don't. No one knows why that is.
It's because we went into that weekend very prepared. We'd worked on coronavirus vaccines for the previous 6 years, and we knew exactly what to do. And we were actually waiting patiently for those sequences because we were so ready to start to make a vaccine in case that the virus did become a pandemic like we're seeing now.
And that's because you knew this kind of pandemic was both likely and surely on the way at some point. You just don't know when. It's kind of like an earthquake.
Yeah. You know, coronaviruses have given us a hint over and over in history before. There was SARS, then there was MERS. And so we kind of knew that coronaviruses as a viral family had pandemic potential. And so we prepared for it.
Dr. Corbett, and this is a concern that many people have raised. They think that the vaccine was developed very, very fast. Could you explain that? Does this type of process of development have been going on for decades?
For decades. Both on what we were doing at the National Institutes of Health, which was basically fundamentally understanding coronaviruses so that we can make a really good vaccine for it. And also the technologies that these vaccines are using, they have been in development for years. And so when you bring those two things together, you become really confident as a scientist that you know what you're doing. And the steps to the vaccine development process embedded in all of those all of the steps are checkpoints where we as scientists and the FDA say, can you go forward? Is this vaccine safe? And does it elicit or make the type of immune response that you would think?
Dr. Corbett, you heard Matthew earlier in the hour. Dr. Fauci, who's been working his whole life on this, taking the vaccine, your vaccine, in public, gave him a certain amount of confidence, but didn't get him over the line to eliminate his hesitancy. Do you have anything to say that might help Matthew get all the way to the vaccine?
Where is Matthew?
Where is Matthew? There he is.
Hi, Matthew. You know, I get it. I completely understand. From where I sit, I think I've realized that through this moment, I sit in a place of privilege where I have information on a day-to-day basis about these vaccines that the general person does not. But the one thing that reassures me constantly is seeing over time more and more people getting these vaccines. The data are so clear and crisp in that they are safe and that they are effective. And also, I would beg of you to not just take my word for it or Dr. Fauci's word for it, but ask people around you how they felt after getting the vaccine. And moreover, how they feel in their confidence around just entering the world again after being vaccinated. And hopefully that helps.
Dr. Corbett, you have talked about the importance of not just saying the things to people, but also listening and meet them where they are. Why is that so important?
Because, you know, a lot of what is termed vaccine hesitancy which I like to call vaccine inquisitiveness, mm-hmm. Comes from populations of people who just haven't been listened to before. And so I think that it was just time for us as scientists and people in the medical profession to just say, we hear you, yes. We understand, and this is what we can give back, which is the information so that you can make an informed choice for yourself.
Very important. We have another question right there from the audience.
Hi, I'm Jessica Jimenez. Thank you so very much for your work for mankind. My husband, myself, we are vaccinated. I was hesitant to vaccinate my 16-year-old, but now I'm afraid to vaccinate my minor. What assurance can you give me about the side effects in the long term? I'm really afraid about the side effects and whatever comes in the long term.
I completely understand that. And one of the reasons why this overarching view that there is fear about side effects for the long term is that what you're seeing is a year or a year and a half of vaccine development. But remembering, as was said before, these vaccines have been, or the technologies have been in people long before even COVID-19 became a thing. Secondly, as Dr. Fauci said, generally speaking, about 95% of the time, any adverse events from a vaccine would happen within that first 2 months, noting that we are over a year from the time that the first person was vaccinated with the Moderna vaccine. And so any safety indications would be showing up over this time, and that with that, you can trust the system. And so as more and more data come out, just look at that data and say, okay, now it's the time that I can trust what I'm seeing.
Thank you so much.
Jessica, I know your family is here in the audience.
Yes.
¿Te sientes mejor con esa respuesta? Do you feel better with that response?
It'll take time, I think,
yeah.
to get over
yeah.
the fear about mm-hmm. vaccines to minors. But
yeah.
yes, thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
Doctor, I think this is so illustrative of the dimensions of hesitancy. Here's someone who is vaccined. She is not afraid of the vaccine for herself. She decided this is good for me. She has a concern about a child, a 16-year-old. She feels it's a different medical question and a different risk tolerance, mm-hmm. Which we all understand. I think we have a zero risk tolerance for our mm-hmm. children in any way. And so the hesitancy to vaccine, as we're just seeing, has so many more dimensions than we might think.
You know, and I like to flip it. Well, first of all, what that is a mother's love.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
a mother cares about their child far more than they could ever dream of caring about themselves. And so I can appreciate that. But what I like to say is that the same way that you think about your risk assessment for yourself, I want to protect myself at all costs so I could live for my kids, so that I could escape under this pandemic for my kids. Think about that same thing for your children. These vaccines, as was determined by the FDA just the other day, are proven to be safe and effective in children. And long-term side effects that you might see in children that people might be concerned about have actually not ever happened from vaccines before. Like, people are thinking about fertility or autism mm-hmm. and all mm-hmm. of these things that just are over and over debunked. And so think about it in that way. You are, in your mother's love and that capacity, protecting your children by giving them this vaccine.
I know that you work with many marginalized communities. What is the main challenge with these communities, and how do you overcome it?
Just being myself, I am from a marginalized community. And so understanding that, and from where I come and from where I've conquered, essentially, and empathizing with those communities back was very important in those moments, I think. And so for me, it's just about being real and open and transparent, and also making sure that people see the passion that I have for the science that we've done even before the COVID-19, but particularly in this moment, and having that transcend to people so that they can feel a part of it, a part of the movement even.
When you were growing up in Hillsborough, North Carolina, what do you imagine if you were still there, your perception of this vaccine would be if you were just still a kid going to school in Hillsborough, North Carolina?
Well, I would imagine, like, my niece, who got a presentation about the vaccine, and I was in it, and she said, Are you famous?
Yes. Yes, she is. As of tonight, she's famous.
You know, my heart will always reside in Hillsboro, North Carolina, where I was raised. And I am very happy to represent for Hillsboro in this moment.
Well, your contribution is immense. So thank you so much, Dr. Kizzy. We really appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for watching our YouTube channel. You should know that you can follow today's top stories and breaking news and catch up on your favorite MSNBC shows all in one place. Download the NBC News app today.